Good morning. This is Pastor Mike Creekmoor, pastor of Bemue Baptist Church in Rocky Mount, North Carolina. And I'm going to try this again. I apologize, having some difficulty at the house this morning. So I had to switch over devices. But the Word of God's going to be taken out, and we're going to get the Word of God out. And so we're praying that it will work this time for sure. I just want to encourage everyone today in this message. That is the reason that I'm here, to encourage you to lift your spirits. We're going to get through this. I firmly believe that. God's going to see us through. To God be the glory. Do not despair. Take heart. Be safe. Be smart. Do not fear. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Jesus is in charge of everything that's going on in my life and your life today. Never underestimate the power of God. And that is my primary message this morning, is God is bigger. God is bigger than all that's going on around us today. There is nothing that you're facing today that is larger than God. There is nothing in your life that is greater than He is. And God is in charge of it all. I'm reminded today of a text that I want to read to you, because that's where I'm taking my focal text from today. And that is 1 Kings chapter 20, verse 28. We're going to deal with this chapter today, but particularly this verse I wanted to read as we start this morning. Then the man of God approached and said to the king of Israel, "This is what the Lord says, because the Arameans have said Yahweh is the God of the mountains and the God of the valleys, I will hand over this great army to you, and then you will know that I am the Lord." You know, I was thinking about that. I really believe that's something that God is trying to teach us, that He is God and we're not. I've lived 60 years of life, and I've looked around, and nobody is greater than my God. I've looked high and I've looked low. I've looked everywhere, and no one can match who our God is. He delights in standing with us when all odds are against us. You remember when the multitude had so great a need, and evening had come, and the people were hungry, and they had no food. The demand was greater than the resources. A boy shows up with some fish and some biscuits, and Jesus fed the multitude. Remember that story? He makes the difference when the odds are against us. Remember when the children of Israel were at the Red Sea? Pharaoh was behind them. The mountain surrounded them. The sea was before them. It was death by sea and death by sword. The odds were against them, but once again, God came through. When Daniel and the three Hebrew boys refused to eat from the king's table, but ate bread and water while the others ate from the king's table each day. But at the end of the day, the scripture says that Daniel and the Hebrew boys, their countenance was better than anyone else's. Odds were against them, but once again, God came through. 1 Kings chapter 20 is one of those chapters that tells us that God is the equalizer when all odds are against us. Today, excuse me, odds are against us. Today, this coronavirus is attacking our nation and attacking the world, a little germ. But let me tell you, Let me tell you, it's almost staggering that a little germ could do what this little germ is doing, virtually shutting down the United States of America, this great country. But let me tell you something, God is greater than this little germ. God is bigger than anything that is happening today. Let me give you the context of what I'm saying this morning. In verse number one, remember we're talking about the Armenians and the king of Israel and the Armenian king. He uses his influence and power, and he has 32 other kings that join him, and that's 32 armies with him, and he besieges the city. He demands from Ahab to give him all his gold, silver, wives, children, etc. Ahab initially says, take all that is mine. You can have them. I cannot stop you. You see, the odds were against this king, the king of Israel. And then Ben-Hadad then decided, I don't want what is yours. I want what belongs to the others, to your people or else. And Ahab tells his leaders that he was willing to give him his, but now he wants theirs as well. And the king, and they say, no, the king, we're not going to comply. And then that's when the preacher shows up. The Lord knows what you're up against, and he sent me to tell you that you will be delivered. And remember, they fought on the mountain, and they won. They devastated the people and those 32 enemies of Israel. They devastated them on the mountain. And remember, the kings, the 32 kings, along with Ben-Hadad, were drinking and partying, and they took all this for granted. Remember, on the mountain, and now they're saying, well, the reason they won is because he's the God of the mountain. And next time we'll fight them on the plain or in the valley and we'll win. Let's get our troops healed up and when we get to the valley, we'll win. But as you read the story and go through the story and understand what is happening here, God, the man of God, tells them that they will win this battle, and they win the battle because God is not only the God of the mountain. And we've had many mountaintime experiences here in the U.S. In the last few years, but now we're having a valley experience. And when God was with us on the mountain, and God will be with us now. God was with us yesterday, and God will be with us today, and God will be with us tomorrow. And God has not left his throne, and God has not diminished in his power, and God is still the all-powerful God. The God who worked yesterday is the same God who works today, and he's forever the same. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so I'm here this morning to encourage you, to tell you to hang in there and to take heart, because God is with us. God is not limited. God is the same God. He's an unlimited God. And if he's not the God of everywhere, he's not the God of anywhere. And if he's not the God of all time, he's not the God anytime. But he's not limited, you see. He is not limited. And so I want to give you several things by way of study this morning as we look at this text. There is no place where God is not. I want you to hear that. There is no season when God is not in season. I want you to listen to that. There is no time when God is not present. The psalmist declared, where can I go to get away from God's presence? If I sin upward, he is there. If I descend downwards. He is there. There's no hymn that goes like this. God moves in a mysterious way. He plants his footsteps on the sea and rides every storm. That's the God we serve. That's the God who is able. That is the all-sufficient God during a day like today. When it's dark, when it doesn't seem fair, when the sun is not shining, when there are countless dangers on all sides of us, God is still God. And in Him I rest this morning. I can count on the promises of God. I can count on God coming through when no one else seems to be coming through. What a mighty God we serve. And today, by way of the study of the Word of God, we are here to worship. We are here to praise God. I'm here to focus on the God who has never let me down and never will let me down. You see, there is no place that life can push you that God will not show up. Don't count God out if life pushes you to a scary place. These are scary times for the child of God, of course. We don't need to fear because the spirit of fear is not of God. But these are, if we're truthful, these are scary times. These are places of uncertainty. These are times that we've never unprecedented been in before. Who would have ever thought that our church houses would be closed and in the confines of my house that I would be preaching the Word of God to my congregation and others online? Who would have ever dreamed of that? But we're at that place, a place of uncertainty. We are also at a place of scarcity. Have you ever seen a day where the stock market's been on such a roller coaster and so many people have lost so much money in the last couple of weeks? But let me tell you something. God is not limited. You see, at that scary place, at that place of uncertainty, at that place where we run out of all resources, God is still God. God is still God. I remember reading when Moses died and Joshua became his successor. Remember what the story says. My servant Moses is dead. But here's the good news this morning. God is still alive. God is still alive. God is still on his throne. God is still able. God is more than sufficient. And so Elijah, remember, he discovered that he was just as much God in Zarephath as he was by the brook. John discovered that he was just as much God on Patmos as he was in Rome. You see, God is God, no matter the circumstances, coronavirus or not, smooth days or not, hand-wrenching times or not. God is still God, and he's still able. And so today, I just want to encourage you, there is no place in life that you can be pushed that he will not show up. Call on the name of Jesus. Jeremiah 33:3 says, call unto him and he will answer you. But not only answer you, keep reading and show you great and mighty things that you know nothing about. I think that's what God's up to today. I think that's what God's plan is today. God is waking up America. Someone says, is the coronavirus a sign of the end times? I don't know. It could be. It may not be. We really don't know. But I do know this, that God's trying to get our attention. God is trying to say something to us, and God's trying to show up in a big way. God is trying to show up in a way beyond the scope of even this technology that I'm doing today. And so just remember that God is bigger. Also, there is no pain or problem in life that He will not invade. Some of you have tremendous pain this morning. Some of you, the problems of life are caving in on you and weighing you down. You're worried, you're concerned. He may not answer with the answer that you prayed for, but He will answer. Paul's prayer about the thorn backs that up. Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane backs that up. He uses life's lessons to teach us that He is the Lord of life. While God does not send evil, bad, or damnable things to us, He allows these things. He does not send pain, sickness, grief, poverty, injustice, but God is able to use trials and tribulations in our lives to help us see in the dark what we cannot see in the light. You see, He helps us see in the darkness what was not seeable in the light. And that's what God is teaching me today, and that's what God is trying to teach some of you today, to understand that He is God. He is the God of the mountain. He's the God of the valley. He's the God of the high moments. He's the God of the low moments. He's the God everywhere in all seasons of life. At every moment in life, He is God, and He's trying to speak not only to myself, but to our nation. Sometimes the only way He can show us that He's in control is to use a situation we can't control. Have you ever thought about that? No one seems to be able to put a handle on this coronavirus. No one seems to be able to control COVID-19. No one seems to be able to control what's going on. But God sometimes will use situations that we can't control to show us that He is in control. Ahab couldn't control the actions of Ben-Hadad, and he found himself in a bad situation. God will always ensure that His name receives glory. And that's the whole theme of the text that I've given you this morning, is to show you that God wants to get glory out of this. God wants the honor in all this. And I don't know God's plan. I don't know what God's up to. I don't know why God is allowing such things today, unprecedented, that I never thought I'd see. But hey, let me tell you something. God has not lost control. God is in control, and His desire is to get glory in it all. You will notice what the text says. Then you will know that I am the Lord. Then you will know that I am the Lord. God is bigger than what we see today. God is bigger than what's going on. God is bigger than anything that's happening in your life. And the text before us today, that's the whole theme of the text before us today. Then you will know, then you will know. They said, I was only the God of the mountain. I was only the God of the mountaintop. I will show them that I am the God of all times. If I'm not the God of the valley and the God of the mountain, then I'm not God. You see, He is God, and He is a God that shows up at all times in our lives. Then I will show you that I am the Lord. And that's what God's trying to teach us today. He is God, and God is bigger than anything that we could ever go through. Today, I hope that this has encouraged you, and I want to pray as we close out our time together this morning. Once again, I apologize for the tardiness. I had a couple of video sessions come on, and I had to change devices on a more reliable device, and now hopefully I've got that down pat, and I won't try that again. But I do want to pray for what's going on in your life, and I want us to have a word of prayer today and pray for the people around us and those that are being infected with the coronavirus and those that are quarantined and those that are out of their routines and the other sick people, and we know many of them. Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you today that you are bigger than anything going on in our lives. You are larger than life itself. And dear Father, we do pray today for those that are sick around us. I know in our own fellowship at Bimini, we have several that are on my heart right now that I'm praying for. Some are facing procedures, some are facing surgeries, others are sick, and others are homebound, others are going through physical things that they've never faced before. And dear Father, also, I know at least one person that has been in our fellowship that has a great-grandson that has been exposed to the coronavirus. Keep him safe. And dear Father, also today, we lift up our missionaries, we lift up our church planners, we lift up our president, our vice president, that are trying to make good decisions for us, all of our governors in all the states. We lift our governors up. We lift those healthcare professionals up that are on the front lines of this battle. And dear Father, they are in harm's way, and I pray that you'll keep them safe. Dear Father, I pray for our school teachers who are teaching children today in a different form and fashion. And dear Father, trying to make adjustments, and I pray for our educators, and I pray for our pupils. Dear Father, I pray for those that are having to be quarantined and those that are trying to stay, those that are in the high risk category, that are trying to stay away from those social distancing themselves from people. Dear Father, again, we pray for safety. We pray for our churches. We pray, I know this is a different day for us too, and we pray for our churches and we lift them up. And dear Father, we pray for our pastors. We pray for our leadership. We pray for those that are trying to make daily decisions in life. And dear Father, we pray for everyone's finances, everyone's jobs. And dear Father, we lift it all up to you today. And dear Father, we thank you that we serve a great God today. And it seems overwhelming when we think about all these prayer requests, but we serve a God who's sufficient and able and can do exceedingly abundantly above and beyond what we could ever think or ask. We love you, Lord Jesus. We're trusting you today. We're keeping our hope and our fixation on you. And we know that you will see us through this, just like you've seen us through many things in the past. You're not only the God of yesterday, but the God of today, and you'll be the God of our future. And we trust you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for joining this broadcast today. And I'll be back. I know on Wednesday night, perhaps before then, but just encouraging people, just trying to give you a word of encouragement. And once again, let me say we're in this together. We are going to get through this. And please do not despair. Trust God during these days. He really will help you. God bless you. And I'll see you again really soon on Facebook Live.